is His holy name. Great and mighty is His holy name. Great and mighty is His holy name. He is an awesome God. God is a faithful God. God is a faithful God. God is a faithful God. He is an awesome God. God is a faithful God. God is a faithful God. God is a faithful God. He is an awesome God. Great and mighty is His holy name. Great and mighty is His holy name. Great and mighty is His holy name. He is an awesome God. God is a worthy God. God is a worthy God. Oh, God is a worthy God. He is an awesome God. God is a worthy God. God is a worthy God. Oh, God is a worthy God. He is an awesome God.
He is holy. He is holy. He is holy. He is an awesome God. He is holy.
God is an awesome God.
He is holy.
God is an awesome God.
He is an awesome God.
wonderful, Jesus. Hallelujah. He is holy. He is worthy and worthy to be praised. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm so thankful for Jesus, for all the things that he's done in our lives. I can't help but to thank God for all the times he's made a way when there's seemed to be absolutely no way whatsoever. God just knows what to do and somehow knows how to do it. So I'm thankful for a God that is able to provide for us and take care of us. Before you're seated, I just want to go to Isaiah 9 and 6. For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. You may be seated. In the beginning, God created the earth and then created man. Almighty God, the Father before a human could become a father. Established as a victorious king before a human could become a king. The king of which David would sing about. Loved people with mercy and grace freely and laid down his own life for his children and showed himself with the attributes of a true father. He has shown himself as a forgiving father. In 1 John chapter 2 verses 1 says, my little children, these things I write unto you that ye sin not. And if any man may sin, or if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And also if you look at the Hebrew in the book of Isaiah, when the prophet proclaimed that the everlasting Father, that same word is also used when he said Father to reveal Jesus Christ in the New Testament. He revealed himself as a loving Father. In John 3 verses 16 says, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Our everlasting Father would robe himself in flesh and come down to earth as a son to save his children. He's a teaching father, teaching things such as the Beatitudes and the parables and even teaching his disciples to pray. He's a giving father. In Psalms 37, 25 and 26 says, I've been young and now I'm old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed. His seed, he is the father. It's his seed begging for, he's never seen his seed begging for bread. He is ever merciful and lendeth, and his seed is blessed. A gentle father who loves his children and waits and never gives up on them. A father who is worthy and worthy to be praised. A God who doesn't leave his child to feel lonely, but yet only to feel loved and to feel cherished. And you know what? I think about the father in Luke chapter 15 verses 20. And I was telling Jonathan how Richard just took right what I wanted to say. But Luke chapter 15 verses 20 says, and he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. The father did not go about his life forgetting his son. He had probably sat around waiting for his son to come home. The reason why he would have been able to run for his son is because he never gave up looking out for his son and never gave up thinking of his son. I can just picture him looking far out through the field every single day or a few times a day to see if he could see his son coming back way off in the distance. Jesus our God and Jesus our Father is the exact same. Before we hear who more on who God is, I want to express my gratitude for a father who teaches, a father who corrects, a father who protects, a father who encourages, and a father who doesn't give up on you when you feel like maybe that father has. A father who provides for you, a father who shows you in which way to go, a father who doesn't just lead by example, but single-handedly had led by example, a father who literally laid down his own life for his own children, a father who loves and a father who cares, a father who doesn't just tell the truth, but he is the truth, a father who is the King of all kings, and a father who is oh so holy, an almighty, most powerful God, a father who knows the end from the beginning, and is the author and the finisher of your faith. A father who gives you another chance when you feel like you don't deserve it. And matter of fact, we don't. A father who is also your advocate, who sets you free and makes you brand new. So to the people here And the people listening tonight, I present to you the Alpha and the Omega, our King and our Father, and his name is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Wonderful God.
Praise God, praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God, church. Christ, the husband of the church. To speak of the husband, you must speak also of the bride, the church. They are one. Romans 7:4 says, wherefore, my brethren, ye also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that ye should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, but that we should bring forth fruit unto God. That's not to say that the law is irrelevant, or that that the law is irrelevant, or that we're not susceptible to the law, but that it is dead, that we are in a new way justified and sanctified. Jesus has made a better way to come to union with him. When we are baptized in Jesus' name, we take on the name of Jesus Christ. Therefore, becoming unionized with Jesus Christ and taking on his name. There must be a death of one to have union or come under authority to another. In Romans 7:4, in the New King James Version says, therefore, my brethren, you also have become dead to the law through the body of Christ, that you may be married to another, to him who was raised from the dead, that we should bear fruit to God. Now I know, men, get over yourselves. You're part of the church, so you are the bride of Christ. Hallelujah. Christ is often spoken of in the Bible as the husband of the church. Thy maker, thy husband. Thy maker is thy husband. The Lord of hosts is his name. Turn, O backsliding children, saith the Lord, for I am married unto you. The church is spoken of the bride, the Lamb's wife. The Spirit and the bride say, come. That is Christ, and the church says, come. In Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 11:2, it says, the Apostle Paul says, for I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin unto Christ. Those that know your Bible know that the relation is often referred to the Bible or in the Word of God. This relationship is referred in the Bible as husband, Jesus Christ, and the bride, the church, in a variety of ways. I'm comparing it earthly to the heavenly, or the physical to the spiritual. The wife gives up her own name and assumes that of her husband. And the church assumes the name of Christ when united with him through baptism in his name. The wife's separate interest is merged with that of her husband. And the church's interest is merged with that of Christ's interest. The reputation of the wife is united to her husband so that his reputation is hers. Her reputation is his. What affects her character affects his character. And what affects his character affects her character. Their reputation is one. So it is with the church. Whatever concerns the church, it also concerns Christ. As the husband of the church, he has promised to do everything that is needful to promote the interest of the church. As a husband is promised to promote the welfare of his wife. As a faithful husband gives up his name, his labor, his talents to promote the interest and happiness of his wife, so Jesus Christ gives up to promote the welfare and happiness of his church. What husband would not gladly give up his life to secure the safety of his bride? Jesus Christ gave up his and himself and to secure the safety of his church, his bride. He is also jealous of the reputation of his church, as a husband ever was, of a reputation of his wife. Never has a human being more so devoted in the interest of his wife, or felt so compassionate. And I forgot to Google, is that a word, compassionate? I forgot to look that up. I was hoping I didn't make up a word, but is that a word? Oh, good, good. So, never has a man been as compassionate as Jesus Christ feels for his church when her reputation and their feelings are injured. Never has someone been more interested in his church than Jesus Christ. He declares in his word that it is better a man had a millstone hanged about his neck and he were cast into the depths of the sea, that then he should offend one of these little ones that believe in him. And he isn't just talking about actual children here. He's talking about his church. That is Christians manifesting the spirit of little children in those that are considered least in the kingdom of God. That's who he's talking about. Yes, he is. Every believer places himself as absolutely under the protection of Christ, as a married woman is under the protection of her husband. The woman naturally looks to her husband to preserve her from injury, from insult, from want. She hangs her happiness on him and expects he will protect her, and as he's bound to do it. Praise God. So Christ has promised to protect his church from every foe. How often have the powers of hell tried to put down the church, but her husband has never abandoned her. No weapon formed against the church has ever been allowed to prosper and never shall. Never will the Lord Jesus Christ forget the relation to the church and to leave his bride unprotected. No, sir. Let all earth and hell conspire against the church, and just as certain as Christ has the power to do it, his church is safe. Every individual's blood-bought believer, every Christian is just as safe as if they were the only believer on earth. The devil can no more pull down a Christian or a single believer in this place to final destruction than he can pull down Almighty God. Taking a believer's life gives Satan no victory. Satan thought he put Christ to death, but what did it get him? Death, hell, and the grave had no power over him. It could not keep him. So it is with the believer. Neither the grave, nor hell, nor any persecution, or any more power in hell can destroy one of Christ's little ones that believe in him than they can destroy Christ himself. Jesus said, because I live, ye shall live also. And he that believeth in me, though he were dead, he shall live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. There is no power in this old world or this universe that can prevail against a single believer, a single blood-bought Christian saint of God, to destroy them. Jesus Christ is the husband and the head of the church, and the head over all things to the church, and the church is safe. Praise God.
That was awesome. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Jesus Christ is the Savior. In the Old Testament, in Isaiah 43 and verse 3, it says, "For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior." Isaiah 43 and 11, "I, even I, am the Lord, and beside me there is no Savior." Hosea 13 and verse 4, "Yet I am the Lord thy God from the land of Egypt, and thou shalt have no God," or no God but me. "For there is no Savior beside me. I am a righteous God and a Savior. There is none but me," Isaiah 45 in verse 21. In the New Testament, God's word, which cannot lie, records Luke 2 and verse 11, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior," capital S, "a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." And the angel of the Lord declared in Matthew 1 and verse 21, "And she," Mary, "shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus." Why? "For he shall save his people from their sins." My. The word Savior is the root of the word salvation. Salvation means to redeem or to preserve from death. It is a deliverance or a means of escape. The whole theme of the Bible is redemption or the salvation of God's chosen people. In the Old Testament, God is called the deliverer of his people, although mainly for the nation of Israel. But in the New Testament, I say to the New Testament, however, Jesus Christ is called the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe. 1 Timothy 4 and 10. 1 Timothy 4 and verse 14, "He was sent to be the Savior of the world." Aren't you happy for that? The Savior of the world. God is called Savior in about 30 times in the Old Testament. It comes from the Hebrew verb yashah, which means to save, deliver, or to give the victory. And while the title Savior was used, God never chose to reveal a name for himself that would fully convey the aspect of his saving nature to man. That is, until the New Testament. There is no accident that Jesus' name in Hebrew, Yeshua, is derived from that Hebrew verb, Yeshah, meaning to save. In the Old Testament, God continuously made a way. He continuously made a way in the Old Testament. But in the New Testament, Jesus became the way. In the Old Testament, God provided salvation. But in the New Testament, God became salvation. In the fullness of time, Brother Richard, hallelujah, God became our Savior. And don't think it's strange. Don't think it's strange, brothers and sisters, because I'm sure God's mercy spared you and saved you from a lot of things before God became your salvation. I know that God saved me from a lot of things before God became my salvation. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. The word Savior appears 24 times in the New Testament. 19 times it is a title that is exclusive to Jesus Christ, and 5 times it is given to God. Now, but that doesn't confuse me one bit, because I know exactly who it is that I worship. I know exactly who it is that I worship and give my praise to. Hallelujah. Raymond Woodward wrote, "When God revealed himself to mankind in the New Testament, he accompanied the revelation of himself in the flesh, or revealed himself in the flesh with a brand new name. And that name is Jesus. This name includes and supersedes all other names of Jesus Christ, or of God rather, in the Old Testament. Jesus' name is far above every name. It means, Jesus' name means Jehovah saves, or God is become salvation. It is the redemptive name, or the saving name of God in the New Testament. It is the name by which salvation is found. Hebrews or Acts 4 and verse 12. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Hallelujah. The Bible says, great is the mystery of godliness. The mystery is that it had never happened before. That God, who is the only Savior, humbled himself and became flesh. That's the mystery that Paul was talking about. God became flesh. He humbled himself and he dwelt among us to bring salvation to a lost and hopeless world. He came to seek and to save that which was lost. And of all the names that God chose to bear, when he revealed himself in the flesh, he chose Jesus. Jehovah saves. God is become salvation. There is only one that can be called Savior. He is the only one that is qualified. Christ alone earned the title. He earned the title of Savior of the world, and he did it by shedding his blood at Calvary. God purchased the church with his own blood. Acts 20 and verse 28. John 1 and 29. Behold, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. Jesus Christ is our Savior. There is only one Savior that is seated upon the throne. That means there is not room for another. Not Buddha, not Allah, not Muhammad. Jesus Christ said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Only Jesus can save you from a lifetime of sin. Only Jesus can save you from the hand of your enemy. Only Jesus can save you from depression, anxiety, and from addiction. Whatever degree of evil or adversity that you are facing, whatever you have need of being saved from tonight, Jesus, my Savior, he can do it. Yes, he can. Hallelujah. The day is quickly coming. Hear me, church. The day is quickly coming when the entire world will desperately be searching for an earthly Savior. Deceived into accepting an earthly Savior. Oh, but I'm glad that we know the one and only Savior of the world. Titus 2 and verse 13, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. There is only one that is coming on the clouds, and his name is Jesus Christ. Oh, Hallelujah. Jesus is our Savior. He is our God and He is our Savior.
Proverbs 18 and 24. A man that hath friends must show himself friendly, and there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. When I had this, I immediately thought of the song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to prayer. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. And as I thought about this song, I thought about, you know what? Most things and great things in life are born out of hurt and pain. And so I went back and I looked at this song and looked at the author who happens, I believe, to be buried not too far from here. His name is Joseph Scriven. He was born in Ireland in 1819. And after graduating with a teaching degree, he fell in love and made plans to marry. But the day before the wedding, his fiance drowned. Devastated, Joseph left Ireland and moved to Canada, where he became a teacher. He fell in love again, only this time a few weeks before their wedding, his to-be bride contracted pneumonia and died. The shattered man took a vow of poverty, sold everything he had, and dedicated his life to helping those who are weak, sick, and impoverished, only to a few years later, because of his impoverished self, not be able to go back to Ireland and help his own sick mother. In his grief and heartbroken state, he wrote a poem, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Joseph Scriven did not even live to see the impact his song had, because it was D.L. Moody that made it mainstream when he found it years later. But he wrote about the friend that, even though life may bring you down, is always there standing by your side, that sticks closer than any sibling, any father, any mother that we know. Some in here may come from perfectly functional families, others not so much. And so sometimes it's hard to recognize what a good brother or good father would be. But I know that I have someone that sticks closer than my brother. That through every situation of my life, he is closer than the mention of his name. That whenever a situation I find myself in, I can call on the name of Jesus, and I have a Father, I have a Savior that is as close and closer than a brother, that reaches down and cares and loves and picks up, even though we don't deserve it. I'm so glad that he sticks so close, even though I don't realize it most of the time. We sing that song, even though we don't realize that he's still working. He is that close that we may not even realize what he's doing, but he is right beside me. He is walking before me, being and sticking close, so that when I always need him, but when I recognize my need, he is always right there. And so I'm so thankful that there is someone that sticks close. The world will forget about you. You have friends. I think there's statistics that say that your best friends in high school, the vast majority of them, they'll forget about you, or that you'll lose focus or you'll lose touch over the time. They say if you have like one or two close friends throughout your life, you're blessed. And you may not feel like you have much right now, but there is a friend, there is a brother, that no matter where you find yourself in life, no matter what grief, what brokenness comes into life, is there to pick you up, to dust you off and say, you know what? There is more, there is greater, there is better. There is always someone there. Sometimes that's all we need, is someone that's gonna stick by us. We may not see the way out, but if I know I have someone with me, I can make it through. And so there is someone always with you, no matter where you go in life. David wrote about it. If I go into the depths of hell, if I go to the east, if I go to the west, if I go to heaven, he is there. You cannot run too far. You cannot find yourself in a place that he is not there. And if you will only but cry out and say, I need you, he is closer than the mention of his name.
I'm going to go to John 14, verses 1 to 3. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. In the time period that Jesus was on earth, it was the Jewish wedding custom would be for the groom to go to the bride's home, and the father of the bride and the family would be there, and he would present the wedding contract, and it's called the ketubah. The groom would then place a cup of wine in front of the bride, and if she were to pick it up and drink it, then it would be as if she were accepting the proposal. And upon acceptance, the groom would tell the bride, you wait here, and I'm going to go prepare my father's house, assuring that he would return to her. And as he prepared the honeymoon chamber at his father's house, she would wait for days, not knowing what time he would return to take her as his bride. And when the groom was done preparing, he would return to the bride's home with the sound of the shofar, which is like a trumpet-like instrument, and he would take her back to his father's house. This is not just some sort of ritual from 2,000 years ago. It's not just some law. It's not just a tradition. It's a timeless prophecy of the return of Christ. We, the church, are the bride of Christ. I'm going to go to Ephesians 5:31-32, and this is the same scripture that David was referring to. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery, the same mystery that David was talking about, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. The creator of the universe robed himself in flesh, became the bridegroom, and wed himself to human nature, conquering death and giving us hope. Jesus is the bridegroom, and he's coming for the church, and we must be prepared for him. I'm going to go to Matthew 25, 1-12. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. Then all the virgins arose, trimmed their lamps, and the foolish said unto the wise, give us your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, not so, lest there be not enough for us and for you, but go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. And afterward came also the other virgins, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, verily I say unto you, I know you not. Jeremiah 2:32, can a maid forget her ornaments or a bride her attire? Yet my people have forgotten me days without number. We must be ready for the bridegroom when he comes, because if we're not, we're going to hear those words, I know you not. He says, yet my people have forgotten me days without number. Forgotten me, forgotten Jesus, forgotten God, and were too late. They went to buy more oil, and they were too late. They missed out on eternal life. Jesus dying on the cross was not just some Roman execution. It wasn't just some carpenter that died on the cross. It was the first part of the fulfillment of a 2,000-year-old prophecy. He is the bridegroom, and he's coming for us. Revelation 19:7, Let us be glad and rejoice to give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready. The church is going to be ready. Now, each individual in the world might not be ready, but the church is going to be ready. We're going to be ready. Amen? We're going to be ready for the bridegroom when he comes. He's coming for his church, and we got to be waiting with our lamps full and waiting to go to his Father's house and hear the words, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." There's no greater privilege than to be awaiting the bridegroom. No greater privilege than to be awaiting Jesus, the bridegroom, the Almighty God who has saved us from our iniquity and given us eternal life. And I don't want to step on Jonathan's toes here, but I remember a song. We used to sing it all the time, and it's a simple song, but it's "What a Day That Will Be When My Jesus I'm Gonna See." And we got to be ready. And I don't know about you, but I know that I'm going to be ready when the bridegroom comes to get us. Why don't we praise God while Jonathan comes?
Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise God. It's been a pleasure to everyone preach. Church, it's been so hot, I feel like I got mosquitoes singing "Nothing But the Blood." It's been so hot lately, and I'm feeling so cold right now. I'm sitting up there, my nose cold, my hands cold. Praise God. My soul. You know you're long, you got a time limit too. Praise God. Amen, amen, amen. Shemaya Israel Adonai Elohenu Adonai Echad. My, everyone just looked at me so weird. I don't know what I just did right there. Hebrew, that means, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord." What's so profound about this statement is that everything mentioned about tonight isn't found in multiple gods. But I come with the understanding that when I call upon the name of Jesus, I get the Father. When I call upon the name of Jesus, I get the husband. When I call upon the name of Jesus, I get the Savior. It's one God. Praise the Lord. Amen. Matthew 13, verses 44 to 46. It says, "Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto the treasure hid in the field, the which when a man hath found, he hideth. And for a joy thereof goeth and selleth all that he hath, and he buyeth that field." Here's the reality, that God is so great that if you ever experience his glory, you'll never be happy until you experience it again. That God is so great that if you're ever filled with the Spirit, you'll never be filled, have filled joy again until you're filled with the Spirit. That God is so great that if you ever feel his love, you'll never be satisfied until you feel his love again. That when a God begins to move upon you, it doesn't matter who's in the way or what you have to sacrifice, that there is a kingdom of heaven waiting for you. And I proclaim to you, church, a God who is not too far, a God who is not too weak, and a God who is not limited. I present to you an almighty God and a soon coming King. Praise the Lord. See, the Old Testament introduced an understanding and a knowledge of a kingdom not of this world. A God who led his chosen people through deserts and lands flowing of milk and honey. It introduced a creator and a powerful God. But even with that understanding that Israel had his chosen nation, God still chose to create himself a body wrapped in flesh. Because to God, it wasn't enough to just lead his people. It wasn't enough to just look upon his people. It wasn't enough to have them only know his voice through other spokesmen. But God desired to know his creation. And he desired to know them so intently that he came down as a man to commune with his creation. And what he brought was not just an understanding of a kingdom. It was an invitation to a kingdom. That the shepherd will become the lamb, and the lamb will become the door to the sheepfold. Understand, it was a king who came down. He did not come down with the intention to invite the rich or the favored or the righteous, but it was a king who came with the intention to invite the broken, the widows, the orphans, the poor, the sinners. And that kingdom that was introduced is still alive today. And Jesus, the Messiah, who once walked upon this world, will come again. Praise the Lord. And on that day, it will disrupt every way of life. And to those who have followed God will come a redemption, shifting the entire course of this world. Praise the Lord. I'm about to be done. The music wants to come up. The kingdom of God is at hand, church. So I've come to tell you, Keep pressing forward. Keep pressing toward the mark. Keep pursuing the presence of God. Look, life may come and it may be heavy, but I understand that there is a promise upon you that in a kingdom will come where sickness won't stand, where violence and anxiety and addictions and even bales will not exist. It is in times of uncertainty that God places what promises upon you. Praise the Lord. Woo! Praise God. I feel good in this place, amen. Praise God. And God, the only requirement to experience Him is faith. It is in the moment when you have enough faith to say, God, I need you, that God begins to interrupt your life. You don't believe me? Well, let's look to His Word real quickly. Genesis 31 and 7 says, yet your father has deceived me and changed my wages 10 times, but God did not allow him to hurt me. Acts 13:30, but God raised him from the dead, speaking of Jesus. Acts 7:9, and the patriarchs moved with envy and sold Joseph into Egypt, but God was with him. And it's in that phrase, but God, that creates a divine intervention that can bring a mess to a miracle. See, David, you should have been killed by Goliath, but God. Mary Magdalene should have died as a prostitute, but God. Andrew, you should have stayed homeless, but God. Richard, you should have never raised in the church, but God. And some of the people in this building today shouldn't be here, but God. And in every moment of your life that God stepped in, it was because that soon coming King placed forth an invitation to your soul that a kingdom of this world is coming. Praise the Lord. And He doesn't want His church dwelling in confusion, anxiety, or brokenness. That though we may be tempted, we will not fall. Though we may be weak, we will not die. Though we may be tired, we will receive rest. Praise the Lord. And so as I'm coming to an ending, I understand, church, that we're not worthy. And we will never be worthy to worship God. But the reason we pray every day and the reason we come to this church every week is because a King placed forth an invitation to all of those who fall short of the glory of God. But this invitation is one that we should have never inherited. See, in His nation Israel, they had rejected Him. And I understand that there are those today who will reject to worship God. But I don't know about you. I have made up in my mind. It doesn't matter what I go through or who falls away or who rejects God. But I'm going to get to an altar and experience a God, not of this world. That I'm going to get to the kingdom. That when God comes and the heavens open and that trumpet sounds and the voice of God echoes through every nature. That God, I want to be ready. God, I want to inherit the kingdom, not of this world. If Jesus gave the unrighteous an invitation to His righteousness, I will do whatever I can to get to an altar. Because one moment in His glory is better than many days spent in bondage by sin. So right now, there's been placed forth an invitation by the Spirit of God to this soon coming King. And whatever you need from the Lord tonight, I'm calling for an altar call. And if you're bold enough right now in this moment to step forth to this altar, because there's something within you that is so hungry and desperate, I want you to come forth right now. Because the Lord is going to move in this place. Praise God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My God. My Lord. In the name of Jesus. Whatever you need from God, it's going to come forth tonight. I'm going to be a little bit bold right now. If you need a healing from God or you need the Lord just to touch you because it's been a while, I want you to come forward. And I believe that if you do that and you step out in faith, it doesn't matter what you came in this place. I don't even care if you know who God is. God is seeking to know you. So right now, if you feel that and you need something for God so desperately, I don't care how long you've been in church, I want you to come forth right now. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. That's it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, in the name of Jesus, I want every hand lifted in the name of Jesus, and we're going to pray. And as we begin to pray, you watch as God begins to perform every miracle, every healing in your life right now. Every voice lifted, God, we come before you, and by the authority of the name of Jesus Christ, I loose the spirit of healing into the atmosphere, and I ask God, loose angels of healing to work and to minister to your congregation. We worship you, Jesus. We glorify you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. That's it, church. Let's begin to worship.